You may need to go over the previous videos a few times before you really get it, because it's a lot of physiology all at once if you haven't seen this material before. Khan Academy also has some good videos that I post on our course room to help supplement these videos here. Let's get into the next step in this story. And to do so, we need to go through the transverse tubules. This is a short form for transverse tubule. We call them T-tubules. Here's a muscle fiber. There's the plasma membrane. But of course, we don't call it the plasma membrane. We call it the sarcolemma, because action potentials can flow along this sarcolemma. Now, what T-tubules are, we have a sarcolemma, but every so often, the sarcolemma tunnels into the cell itself. We can see that right here, right there. You can see these other little, they look like wormholes entering the cell. So when the action potential travels along the sarcolemma, it enters these T-tubules or transverse tubules. So the action potential, which is electrical energy, is actually flowing along and around these myofibrils that we see. And in the myofibrils, we can see the actin and myosins overlapping in there. So let's get some terminology out of the way here before we move on. Sarcoplasmic reticulum is all these yellow tubes that you see. It's kind of like endoplasmic reticulum, but their job in muscle fibers is to store calcium. We will see why that's important in a little bit. Now, the sarcoplasmic reticulum, when they run parallel to the transverse tubule, they run parallel on either side. Well, those are called terminal cisternae, which is a thicker part of the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So most of the calcium is stored in this terminal cisternae part of the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So what we call a triad is these three tubes right here. It's the T-tubule in the center with the terminal cisternae on either side. And there's your triad. So let's see why these structures are important to finish our story of muscle contraction. In the last video, we looked at the neuromuscular junction, where neuron meets muscle fiber. There's your action potential arriving at the axon terminal. And we went through that whole story, and we saw that, yeah, we get this end plate potential. Review the last video to see the details of that. And if it's strong enough to get to the sarcolemma here, then we have an action potential. We see an action potential. That's what they're symbolizing by this lightning bolt. So here, right at this point, the muscle fiber is excited. See, excitation. But has it contracted yet? It has not. So more things have to happen. We have to get from excitement, all the way to contraction. That takes time. It's a fraction of a second, but it still takes time. So the time that it takes from the muscle fiber to be excited to the time it contracts is called excitation-contraction coupling, or just EC coupling. So what are the steps of EC coupling? Well, that starts with excitation. Right here, the action potential travels along the sarcolemma just like it's doing, and it will go down all the T-tubules. This causes, here's a terminal cisternae that stores calcium that we saw in the previous slide. So when the action potential travels down the T-tubules, this stored calcium in the sarcoplasmic reticulum, specifically the terminal cisternae, gets released. So calcium is now free inside the cell. And where does this calcium go? It binds to troponin. Important to remember from the previous video that troponin is one of those proteins that blocks these actin binding sites, or active binding sites. So when calcium binds to troponin, tropomyosin moves out of the way. Remember that orange protein blocking those binding sites right here? So calcium binds to troponin, causing tropomyosin to change shape. So all of a sudden, the binding sites are exposed, like you can see here. And because they're exposed, the myosin head can bind to it and produce what we call a power stroke. You can see that by the arrow. sliding the actin towards the center of the sarcomere, which, times that by 1,000 times here, causes the muscle to contract. So last two key terms is when myosin binds to actin, that's called a crossbridge. When myosin moves actin towards the center of the sarcomere or slides it, that's called a power stroke. So now the muscle is contracted, but how does it relax? Well, when calcium gets released to remove the contact inhibition, meaning remove tropomyosin, get it out of the way, well, as soon as calcium gets released to cause that cross bridge and power stroke, well, it gets pumped back almost immediately. And you can see that everything will relax at that point. So calcium enables myosin head to bind to actin because it takes the blockers out of the way, it removes contact inhibition. But just as quick as it does that, it gets pumped back into its storage facility, the sarcoplasmic reticulum, or more specifically, the terminal cisternae. When that happens, if there's no calcium, well then, tropomyosin changes its shape back in order to inhibit the contact. We saw something similar to this before. Here we have a relaxed sarcomere from Z-disc to Z-disc. We can see there's a certain amount of overlap. We can see that the myosin heads cannot bind because of the contact inhibition from troponin and tropomyosin. In this second image, we see a contracted sarcomere. The Z-disc to Z-disc span is shorter, so it contracted, so there's more overlap between actin and myosin. We can see the crossbridge being formed from the myosin heads binding to actin, and the power stroke sliding the actin towards the center of the sarcomere.